It very simply comes back to what's our relationship with nature, because nature is our life support system. So the earth supports us rather than runs us rather than us running the earth. So when I think about all these issues, I'm always asking, what's our ecological relationship with each other, but with the planet as well? And I come at that not, I hope, sounding like too much of a narrow ecological radical, but as somebody who I think is getting right to the heart of the issue of what are we doing with our life support system, and being very cognizant of the trends, the downward trends there, the degradation that we cause of that life support system, and therefore what we need to do to turn that around. And of course, that then affects every aspect of our lives. That's my essential focus. And but of course, I can take any of those issues down, I hope, to a very practical level, a really here and now level, because it is quite overwhelming to have to think about the sheer interdependence and the sheer integration of all of those issues. So that's why it's always important to get down to some brass tacks, some very particular issues here and now. It comes back to that. It's about living well with the planet to give nature a chance to recover.
Studio this morning, I have Rod Oram. Rod, originally from the UK, came to New Zealand early in the year 2000 to become the business editor for the New Zealand Herald, and is a business journalist who has a very wide understanding of what's happening in New Zealand across the board, solely because he's been anchored in that realm since he's been here. And so I want to say, kia ora, Rod. Thank you for bicycling to the radio station to speak with me this morning.
Kia ora, Tim. A huge pleasure to be here, and always fun to be on the bike. And fortunately, it didn't rain, although I was prepared in case it was.
Good for you. I mean, you're walking your talk, or you're riding your ride, so to speak. Well done. Rod, you've been into this radio program a number of times, and I've really appreciated your depth of looking at some of the questions that are not really being covered by mainstream media. And I really appreciate the fact that you will just look deeper. And we in New Zealand at the moment, we are on the threshold of huge change, and would like to think that we are geared up to be able to shift the country into a new paradigm of regenerative agriculture, having a synergistic relationship with business, having new ways of producing energy, good health systems, a top educational system. Can you tell us what's your focus at the moment?
It's very simply comes back to what's our relationship with nature, because nature is our life support system. So the earth supports us rather than runs us rather than us running the earth. So when I think about all these issues, I'm always asking, what's our ecological relationship with each other, but with the planet as well? And I come at that not, I hope, sounding like too much of a narrow ecological radical, but as somebody who I think is getting right to the heart of the issue of what are we doing with our life support system, and being very cognizant of the trends, the downward trends there, the degradation that we cause of that life support system, and therefore what we need to do to turn that around. And of course, that then affects every aspect of our lives. That's my essential focus. And but of course, I can take any of those issues down, I hope, to a very practical level, a really here and now level, because it is quite overwhelming to have to think about the sheer interdependence and the sheer integration of all of those issues. So that's why it's always important to get down to some brass tacks, some very particular issues here and now.
Excellent. Thank you, Rod. Yes, because I have really cut it down to so finely that our planet loans us a body, loans us free air, free rainwater, and until recently, a free food chain. And then I turn the question around, what do we do in reciprocity? So there is this connection all the time, and we're taking in the whole human race, 7.7, nearly 8 billion of us. We're taking in huge amounts of oxygen into our lungs every day. We're consuming heaps of water, and we're eating a lot of food, and then we're producing all this waste. So we are making a huge impact, are we not?
We are. And the wonderful thing about that, though, is that nature, if we listen to nature, if we take our understanding from nature, does know how to have completely circular systems, so that everything that's used is reused. Everything that is depleted gets replenished. And that's the essence of the living system, which is the planet. So if we make sure that we're working with nature and not against it, and we're making sure that we're giving these incredibly complex ecosystems the chance to recover themselves because we're taking the pressure off them, then those ecosystems become far more resilient and can deal with far more variation. They also then are far more productive. So potentially they can support more people on the planet as long as we're making sure that we're doing everything in sync with nature.
You're talking about the circular economy that we have to introduce.
That's one of the concepts, and I think it's a very helpful concept because it's a very important bridge between how we think about our linear system now, which is to extract things from ecosystems in order to make and then consume things, and then often have pollution, which is obviously a very negative thing to put back into the ecosystem, or loss of resources in that very linear system. So if we start talking about how do we make sure that everything we do loops back, so we make sure that we completely understand how to unmake everything we make, so that all the natural resources that go into what we make can then be reused again, or the human-made resources, and we have to be very careful of those. We can make those, but we need to make sure that, again, they are working with nature, not against it. They're not building up, for example, heavy metals as a toxin in ecosystems.
Yes.
So in that circular system, we're also making sure that those human-made materials can be completely reused again. And so completely making and unmaking, but then making sure along the way that we are reusing things or recycling things, repurposing things to the nth degree so that we are completely a part of natural systems.
It's called closing the loop in one way. And the other thing is, too, is the idea of cradle to cradle. You're familiar with that terminology?
Yes, it's one I like a great deal because it sort of encapsulates that sense of a life cycle that brings you back to where you started so you can start all over again. And those concepts now have been around and being applied to some extent by some real champions, but we've got a long way to go before all of our human activity fits that, has that right relationship.
I remember back in 1993, Rod, when I saw a program, a German program on Deutsche TV, and it had the BMW works, and BMW were looking at producing a vehicle, and it was all computerized, so that they'd start off virtually with nothing, and they'd build the vehicle from a chassis, and then the cab, and then the engine, and etc. And it all was put together by a computer and a robotic assembly line. And they said that when the car ran off the production line, that when this car had fulfilled its term with planned obsolescence, the fact is, once that car was ready to be taken out of use, they would just flip or reverse the computer program, and the technology then would start taking that BMW to pieces, to its constituent parts from the other end, until we virtually ended with very few pieces in the final analysis that could then be obviously smelted or used in another way. But essentially, it built the car up and it disassembled it, and it was all computerized, and yet we haven't heard about this now, and it's close on 27 years.
The worldwide motor manufacturing sector has made some progress on using more materials that are recyclable, but there's still a very, very long way to go on that.
Yes. Okay. Well, look, there are so many things. So I'll let you tell us about something else maybe, or you may wish to carry on this conversation, or you may wish to also mention some of the other things, because time is running short for us, Rod.
Very much a long-standing preoccupation is how do we all learn and encourage each other to change? And obviously this has become a good deal more important since COVID-19 became such a focus and influence on our lives. And we've gone through an extraordinary few months in New Zealand where we have coped with the virus well. To me, one of the most extraordinary statistics is our death rate in New Zealand was just over 2 people per million, but in the UK, it is 900 people per million. So the death rate in the UK from COVID-19 is 400 times ours. So we need to remind ourselves that we have done that well. But in the last month or so, it's been this month of June, we've become rather fractious. We've become rather anxious. I sense we're sort of shutting down a bit in terms of our hope to try to come out of the COVID crisis heading off in a different and better direction. So I'm very concerned about how we do encourage people. And obviously, many people are still struggling with all kinds of things. They might be unemployed or stresses and strains in the family, or they're worried about their health. I do appreciate all that. So it is about being able to support each other through this, but needing to think, encouraging people to think about how we might do things differently and better. Now, there's a lot going on. Some of my favorite examples are the Aotearoa Circle, the late Sir Rob Fenwick co-founded with Sir Jonathan Porritt. And of course, very sadly, Rob died in early March this year after a very, very long battle with cancer. And so he is a great loss. But the Aotearoa Circle is a very interesting group of leading New Zealand businesses and government agencies, and very much the senior people in those organizations involved. And the central theme of it is about putting natural capital, i.e. ecosystems, at the center of everything we do. And it's very interesting to see rather conventional companies starting to think in those terms. So there's very good work going on in the Aotearoa Circle and some real thoughts going into what this future looks like. Then we recently had Vision Week, which a bunch of organizations got off the ground, and there was a terrific outpouring there in terms of presentations and ideas. There's various websites that are trying to bring people together, like a new New Zealand. There's also an Aotearoa 2020 vision online in social media. So we've got all these ideas going on, but we've got a very tired and exhausted political system.
Very much.
that seems unable to get its head around. It is so focused on COVID-19, and I appreciate it is pretty all-consuming, to be thinking about how our responses to COVID-19 are also not only dealing with issues here and now, but also helping to lay the groundwork and contribute towards that future. So I don't know the answer to that. I've got a few thoughts about how people might want to respond in the next few months leading up to the election and how they might want to vote in the election. The essential point on that last one is that rather than reverting to tribal politics, i.e. just naturally voting for the party that one has most usually voted for or identifies most strongly with, prioritizing your own life and your own thinking, what's most important to you, and therefore finding the party that best aligns with that. And it may not be your traditional party. So I think the idea of voting for the things you care about most importantly, the top one or two issues, rather than your normal tribal loyalty, I think will be a big help in this election.
I know there's a lot of interest in change at the moment, most definitely. And there are people, and me included, looking at, do we have to have party politics? Can we not actually find a system where you can actually vote for the person and see what they actually embody and what their vision is? But again, this is all, we haven't got time to be able to talk about all this in many ways. But
yeah, I just leave one other thought, is that we often say, oh, the electoral cycle's too short in New Zealand, is 3 years, it needs to be longer so a government can get more things done. I think that ignores the fact that the issues we're working on are very long-term, and therefore we need a strong societal consensus on what we're doing that completely transcends the electoral cycle. Because you'd never have an electoral cycle long enough for, you know, a government to make a big impact. So an election then becomes about, well, we have these common goals, what we're trying to achieve, and these programs that are doing it. So who's executing best? And so the election largely comes around that. The best example over the years has been Ireland, particularly in the 80s and 90s, and where there was a very strong social consensus on what the country was trying to achieve and how. But quite fascinatingly, after a political stalemate now over some months, a grand coalition has been formed between the two major parties.
Yes.
And I think that's a very encouraging idea. Also, the Germans have had grand coalitions too. They're complicated to organise and to keep functioning. But to me, that is a good sign of where a society has a common sense, a common understanding about what it needs to do, a common sense of how it's going to do that, and a real strong common sense of commonwealth about all that it's trying to achieve and how that's measured. And wealth, obviously not in a narrow monetary and financial sense, but across all aspects of life.
Thank you. Yes, I've got Irish heritage in there. I want to be able to talk to you a little bit about the fourth industrial revolution and New Zealand becoming a cashless country, because I know that it's all interlinked with the fact that everything's going to be, or it's projected to be, 5G enabled. And so we're going to be having so-called 40,000 odd satellites circling our planet due to Elon Musk. And then they're selling us the story that we'll be able to do so many more things because everyone's going to have this technology. And the big thing that I've noticed now is that the youth up until maybe 30, 32 years of age or wherever are not carrying cash at all at the moment. And so we're finding, I think, at New Zealand's close on 48% of all transactions are cashless, and it won't be too long before we have a trigger that says, okay, we're not going to have cash anymore. And I know that Sweden is hugely on that path. Have you anything to say about how the cashless society and maybe the fourth industrial revolution, which is just gigantic from a planetary scale, is going to affect us?
Let me just initially just step through a number of big stages there. The fourth industrial revolution is very radical in terms of how we make things and thus unmake them. So all sorts of extraordinary new technologies. At the highest level, I'm in favour of that, but I'm concerned that there is nowhere near a strong enough connection, again, I stress, back into ecosystems there. So I'm all for the industrial revolution as long as we understand that we're not trying to reinvent or remake natural ecosystems. We're trying to make sure that what we do fits in with them. So I think you can align those two there. The next thing is on communications. 5G is astonishingly powerful and it will be very useful because we do need to be monitoring a lot about, a vast amount about what's going on with not only in our own personal lives, but again, the ecosystems in which we live in. So the ability to be able to collect and analyze and share a great deal of data is also very important in terms of helping us understand with the enormous complexity of the systems we're working with. So again, I'm all in favor of that. And I'm not concerned. I have thought about, I have done some reading on whether 5G is healthy or unhealthy for us. And I come down firmly on the side, it's okay for us. It's not, you know, it's not a source of COVID-19, or it's not, you know, going to be a source of all sorts of other ailments. Then when we get down to the third part of your proposition there about a cashless society, I think that's a very natural evolution to have moved on from physical currency. So in the history of humankind, we've already moved on from initially we just traded items amongst ourselves and people in close proximity to us, or the tribe next door, or, you know, down the river. We then moved on to a medium of exchange, which was based on something precious. So a gold coin, clearly identified and hard to replicate, and with a known quantity of gold in it, or silver, or, you know, copper down to the cheap coins. And in due course, the amount of trading we wanted to do amongst ourselves meant that we had to have a greater store of money to be able to facilitate that exchange. But we also needed, in due course, ways to be able to transfer that money that didn't require actually handing over a gold coin or shipping it off to somebody. So that gets us into what we call fiat money. So fiat, in the sense of borrows from the Latin, about to declare, and we're saying that we're going to create this New Zealand dollar, and it's worth a dollar. And so that's the way money works these days. But it's remarkably how long some old systems lingered, and yet conversely how quickly new systems came in. I'm old enough that I was studying economics at university when Richard Nixon finally took the US dollar off the gold standard.
72, wasn't it?
Yes, absolutely. And it's this totally extraordinary thing. And I don't think people younger than you and I would credit that that was the case, but it is. And of course, we're now seeing extraordinary further developments, initially born out of the global financial crisis and now the COVID crisis, where we're looking for reserve banks, central banks, as the guardians of money and the creators of money, and governments, likewise, to find new ways to keep things working.
Yes.
So thus we're getting quantitative easing, for example, from reserve banks, where they're offering to buy in bonds from initially government bonds, and then they've been extending it to all kinds of other instruments this time around rather than the GFC. And they then credit the account at the Reserve Bank of an investor or a commercial bank with that new money, which then gets recirculated out into the economy. And I thought a great deal about quantitative easing as it became well established during the global financial crisis.
And that's called printing of money for people.
Yes, it is. But of course, it isn't literally in the printing of money. Although, of course, central banks are still in the business of creating physical currency. So the link back to your point is, will we see a time when there is no longer any physical currency, you know, banknotes or coins? Yes, we will. And I know myself that I hardly ever use any physical currency, and I'm completely relaxed about that and find coins and banknotes
tedious.
Slightly inconvenient.
Because they've gone on to Bitcoin and blockchain, and I want to be able to just recognize that. But the question is that people would call me an activist. And when you have activists in the field doing things, taking care of our environment, and there's a lot of good environmental activists in the world, if I became such a nuisance with my goodwill to the degree that I'm, say, down in Lake Waikaremoana Sunday morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, and I want to get some petrol for my car, and I get my card out and put my card out into the machine, and it says, whoop, gone. You've got to contact your bank, because the establishment, for whatever reason, does not like my activities. Then all of a sudden, I'm completely neutralized. And my concern is that if we go on and have a cashless society, anybody who is seen out of favor could then be automatically cut out of the system. And so there could be in the future no activists at any level at all, because the status quo does not like their behavior of goodwill and standing up for the future of nature, of our biosphere.
We'd want to be really sure that people's freedoms, as expressed in the Bill of Rights, absolutely cover that too, so that the government couldn't shut you down that way. I absolutely agree with that. And therefore, those people who feel drawn to, empowered and very committed to being activists can still do that. No two ways about that. But I don't think that, I think that properly applied is going to be far more of a safeguard of liberties than actually still being able to have banknotes and coins. So, for example, should you be in that situation, it would still be possible, late Karamoana, if the government had shot you down, that you had the good sense to have a debit card with you that a friend gave you that has no connection to you at all, you just swipe the debit card and still get your petrol. Well, of course, by then it won't be petrol. It'll get your shot of electricity or hydrogen.
Very good. Okay, because we'll just quickly jump over the fact is that I can see a city of Auckland in the future, and we have got 100% electric cars, and at 8 o'clock in the morning, they're all sitting mile or kilometre after kilometre after kilometre, not moving and stationary, all jam-packed on the motorway, endeavouring to get into town. Because we've got all the electric cars, but we actually have not got a motorway system that's far too small, and we can't have a big motorway system because they're just taking over the place. So we're going to have to shift everybody out of electric cars to a degree and find electric public transport, are we not?
We are, because electric cars only solve some problems. First of all, emissions, and then they are far less complex and require as much maintenance as fossil fuel-driven cars. So electric cars only solve a few problems, and we need to make sure that we make those electric cars in ways that are completely recyclable, including all their batteries. Similarly, autonomous cars don't solve traffic jams at all. It means that you can get a higher density of vehicles on the road because you can start getting vehicles travelling in automatic platoons, as the term goes. Again, it doesn't solve anything. We humans have to build and differently and change our lifestyles differently to make it possible for us to be able to get around in a relatively dense city. But there are plenty of cities that already look like that in terms of low private transport use and high public transport use. And there's no reason why Auckland can't be like that too.
Could you name a few? Because this is important for us to understand. Is there a few cities?
Oh, I think the best example in sort of the English language world, because I'm still rather dependent in my insights into things by being able to read and talk with people. Although I must say, you know, automatic translation of things is wonderful these days. So that starts to broaden my horizons. But London has done a good job with its congestion charging and reducing vehicles in the city and improving public transport, but a massive and very difficult and expensive rebuild, for example, of the London Underground system. New York is even more extreme because its subway system was in far worse state than the London system was, and they're really struggling to rebuild that. But just the news this past week, New York City is closing 100 miles of streets in the city, banning cars from them and increasing those pedestrianized streets and increasing cycle lanes as well. But I think the best example, which is not English speaking but very accessible, Copenhagen would be a very good example of where there is surprisingly little private transport in vehicles, a lot of private transport sort of in bicycles and walking. And so that would be an example of a very livable city.
Yes, I know. I think they had a situation in Brazil, in Curitiba. Jamie Lerner, who was the mayor, who really shifted things and turned that city into a city that really focused on public transport. You have to always have a champion, don't you?
You do, but you also need terrific buy-in from the people, because champions can't do this on their own. And so I'm always coming back to, how do we encourage people to be part of this change, these changes, and be very willing contributors to them? Not in a passive sense, like, oh, yeah, well, I'll take the bus, but in terms of active engagement about trying to encourage others to make the change, pushing politicians to enable the change, persuading businesses to offer the alternative. So it's about people being very active participants in change, not just on this transport thing, but across the piece.
Well, I think this is one of the big challenges here, because Green Planet FM has been going on now for 17 years. And, boy, it's pushing water uphill still. And to get the buy-in, and I think it comes right back to the individual and how it's parenting, bringing the children into the world. And the next thing is, how do we instill values and virtues in a child? And is there a father present as well? Because I've heard of many situations that a lot of disaffected youth today, quite often there's not a father present, and the mum has to struggle to bring up the children. And I've worked 8 electronic doors deep in Parimarimo Maxi Security Prison, and I've been with all the hardened criminals, or a good percentage of them, teaching them numeracy and literacy, and a lot of them have no idea who their father is. And so I think it comes right back to family values, Rod, and even being able to talk about consciousness or have some sort of spiritual context, because the church in many cases has failed over the last 70 years or so. Some might say it's failed far, far longer than that. But how do we instill in a child that they've got a candle, and that we need to be able to nurture this flame inside that child so that they recognize that they have far more capabilities? And it's like every child born into this realm is an energy bundle of exponential potential. How do we help this potential become far more, and also to be able to be integrated within the local community and society as a whole?
It's one level astonishingly easy and completely timeless. It's about being able to bring young people into the world and nurture them on that journey, in their family, in their community, in their school. There is nothing radical or new about this. We've always known that it takes a village to raise a child. And I would differ with you in one respect about the importance of having a father figure there. I know some wonderful people who have grown up in the absence of a biological father in their lives, because they have all the support, all the type of influence that would come from a good father, coming from others. So I know that sounds ridiculously simple, but of course it's obviously fiendishly difficult to actually practice and make common that sense of how we do support not just young people. It's about supporting each other all the way through. As we, the older I get, the more conscious I am that at some point I will be receiving more than I already do receive more than I give. But I'll tell you a wonderful story of a great old friend of ours, Peggy, who was a fellow parishioner of ours at St. Matthew in the City. And we first met Peggy when we moved to Auckland and to St. Matthew's. And she was already in her, I think just turned 80 at that point. And she always had such a huge interest in the world and was always asking wonderful questions. And she read voraciously. But importantly, the social contact was really important to her. She lived in her own home until well into her 90s. Before then, she had just a short spell, I think perhaps about a year, as memory serves, in a retirement home. But when she died, her funeral at St. Matthew's was quite amazing. I think there were about 300 or 400 people there. And a large proportion of them, other than her immediate family, were people like my wife and I, who had only got to know in her later years. And so we also, obviously, then, and the older I get, the more I hunger for a society in which older people can feel that they've still got something to offer, as Peggy did, and still be very much a part of the community as Peggy was, and therefore able to lead a very, very rich life right to her last days. So to me, it isn't just about our young people, though they're incredibly important, but it's how we humans relate to one another regardless of our age.
Oh, very true. I'm speaking with Rod Oram, renowned New Zealand investigative journalist of political, economic and business matters throughout the country. Oh, very true. I mean, I love speaking to older people because they've got such a varied and interesting story to tell. And I've heard recently of the having men's sheds put around, particularly in Australia, around retirement villages, so that men, when a man goes to a retirement village, a man usually likes to do things practically, whereas a woman can socialise, she can knit, she can crochet, she can do things with her hands and talk with her woman friends, where a man sometimes likes to have tools, he likes to make things or repair things, etc. And we're finding that men's sheds are starting to come into focus around retirement villages because a lot of men who are put in a retirement village know they close down and they usually pass away very early in the piece, whereas the women, for reasons unknown, are far more resilient. So I think, again, is how we occupy our elders, and I honestly think we need to hear all their stories and find a way in which we can have somebody either sit and video or record or just acknowledge them and validate them.
Yes, because inevitably we're all on a curve that takes us back in time. So, and tragically this happens to some people too young and or too quickly, where their memory starts to shut down, their interests start to shut down. And so it takes a lot of love and a lot of kindness and forbearance to for us all still to want to engage with people as they go into the twilight and, you know, the fading years of their lives.
I did an interview of Sue Kedgley some years ago, very important, because she was a Green MP. She also happened to be the chairperson of the Parliamentary Health Committee, so the $25 billion odd dollars that went through every year on health. And she would oversee all things that going through, all legislation, etc. And she mentioned that a lot of the land that are got hospitals on were not only given to the community by Māori, but they used to have big vegetable garden. And a lot of the food, fresh food, came from the vegetable garden straight to the patients in the hospital. And I know that this is not happening in old people's homes, and I have been witness time and time again to the fact that our food, New Zealand, that land of milk and honey, we are not really giving the food which nourishes our brain. It's very important to have the highest quality vegetables and fruit and meat and poultry and fish that's vital, full of minerals and vitamins, and we're not actually doing that too. So, and I've noticed this. I wrote about this 40 years ago in a publication. And again, so we're challenged on so many levels, Rod.
We are. Yes, absolutely. Actually, there's a lovely historic connection because here we are sitting at Unitec here in Auckland on the Carrington campus, which was, of course, the Carrington Mental Institution. I'm not sure what the term they used at the time. And this was very extensive lands. Do you know if food was ever grown here for the people who lived here?
I don't know, but there's a big place where there are still gardens now, and there have been gardens here for quite some time. Mm. The Organic Society has been involved here. Yeah, so here I am. I'm in a mental institution right at the moment, dealing with the profundity of the human race not being able to become truly aligned with their inner self and stop being fragmented and dysfunctional and get on and become part of a dynamic community.
But I take that those important ideas forward. So where we're sitting, the northern end of the campus is going to be redeveloped as housing. As I think I've got it the right way around, Unitec's going to go back down the other end of campus, south end. And this has been fast-tracked by the government as a part of its COVID response infrastructure development. And it's really important how well this community is designed here and created so that, for example, it is possible for people to grow things, whether it be in a communal garden or there is an ability right around your house or within your house to grow things and to create that community. Very interestingly, my wife and I last weekend were visiting young friends. They're friends of our daughter out at Hobsonville. And I've long been interested in Hobsonville from the early days because there was a real emphasis there on how to, first of all, house more people well in per hectare, but then also how to create community in a new community like that. Lynn and I have been out that way once in a while. I sometimes cycle through Hobsonville, sometimes we walk up there as well. But I was very encouraged to hear how that community growth is happening. Unsurprisingly, it's perhaps a lot of it revolves around young families, which is a very natural thing to do, which is good. I'd love to know how it's working with older people, because I see there's a retirement homes there now as well. So to be very intentional about how we help design and create and nurture communities in all their richness, including the growing of some food, I think is very important.
There's 100 community gardens here in Auckland, Rod, and there are so many different cultures involved. I think it's quite fascinating that you have a huge array of, a huge numbers of different people from different cultures growing food, because a lot of them grew food when they lived in their countries, particularly as a lot of them have come from what you would call as developing countries today, and they are very happy working among others to grow food because they know that they're going to have a very healthy food, they're going to be able to share recipes, they've got an interest, and they learn all the skills of communication. And so here we have 100 of them here in Auckland, and I think that's a wonderful thing.
It is, and again, just zooming out to the very, very big picture, we've got this extraordinary migration of people to cities. So it was only 2007 that the United Nations deemed was the year that at last 50% of people lived in urban areas. And that's going to continue. There will be countries where 85% of people will be urban dwellers. Obviously, somewhere like Singapore, that's already true. And therefore, the ability for us to be able to grow food in cities, even cities that dense, is widely recognized as an important goal for two reasons. It's good to have food close to people, but we can't provide enough food using conventional agriculture out in sort of broad acres. But you can still grow things very naturally in cities. And I think that's a very important part of this view of the future. I talk a lot about how do we bring nature back into cities. So we have ecosystem services, which are all part of our life support system, but we treat those with respect, and so those ecosystems remain healthy. And there are some wonderful organizations around. One of my favorite is, it's called a group of biophilic cities, i.e. cities that love biology, love life. And fascinatingly, one of them is the city I was born and grew up in the UK, which was Birmingham. And in Birmingham is the absolute heart of industrialization of the UK.
Spaghetti Works came to me.
It's a Spaghetti Junction, that's
yeah,
right.
That's right.
And but one of the reasons that Birmingham today has a good bedrock for biophilia is that there were Victorian captains of industry who believed that parks and other sort of healthy outdoor pursuits were really good for people. And so that's how the city grew in Victorian times. So Birmingham's got a surprisingly large percentage of parks for its population. And then, of course, there were other great industrialists in Birmingham, like the Cadbury family, who were Quakers.
Yes, that's right.
Who built, out of Bourneville, not only pretty modern plants, chocolate-making and cocoa facilities, but also planned communities where people were treated with respect, workforce were treated with respect, and well-paid, and as an employer, the Cadbury family had a very strong sort of social conscience.
Yes, well, a social conscience, because my question here is where are the pillars of society? Where are our civic wise ones? Where are our kuia and kaumātua, because at the moment our glaciers are still shrinking and the waters around New Zealand are still warming. That's a fact. And they get Australian grouper coming over to New Zealand. They've had walu down from Fiji. They've had, that was over the last, say, 15 years. We've had even mahi-mahi, all these tropical fish visiting our waters, etc. So we're still experiencing warming at one level, and yet I don't know where our leaders are at the moment. And I think this is a very important issue. We just don't seem to have anybody standing up, particularly in the business realm. And we need them. The children need to have somebody to see as a role model. What can you suggest?
There are people out there, and rightly, they are not necessarily very dominant or high profile. And I think that's good, because I've always had a view of leadership that it's a sort of a bottom-up rather than a top-down.
So I'm
quite distrustful of people who call themselves, I'm very distrustful of people who call themselves strong leaders, who are basically fairly charismatic, so they do have followers, but they're basically telling their followers what to think. Whereas leadership for me is, could be a child, a young child in a family, sort of saying, well, I think we should do this and not that. Or it's a few people in a street getting together to do something. So I think there's a great role for leadership wherever we are. You know, in whatever community you're in or whatever family you're in a non-dogmatic but hopefully an encouraging way, help, well, lead. So having said that, my favourite demographic is obviously young people, and it's quite remarkable how young people have had an impact on the debate, particularly on climate crisis in the last couple of years, and organising the school strikes and the rest around the world and here in New Zealand. And it was very interesting at the local government elections last October. There was a number of young candidates elected, Palmerston North, Wellington, Kapiti Coast, the ones that I'm most familiar with. People on the Kapiti Coast, like Sophie Hanford, who organised the school strikes when in New Zealand while she was still at school. And I think only just turned 18 in time for the election. And I know that a number of her key campaign staff were too young to vote. But and I know Sophie's doing a superb job on Kapiti Coast. I've been involved in a couple of online forums, town hall meetings online. And she just has such a wonderful way in terms of how she engages with people. So they are around, and never enough, not strong enough, not organized enough.
Short of cash, too.
Yes.
That's a big one.
Yeah, but you can attract money, you can build resources in various ways. So I think of it as a bit like yeast. I think we've got some pretty yeasty people out there, and we just need to nurture them a bit and really get that yeast bubbling away.
Thank you. When I saw The Planet of the Apes way back in the 1960s, I think it was, or late 60s, that shocked me. It really shocked me, particularly the first one, when Charlton Heston saw the Statue of Liberty, and I was astounded. And then we have now The Planet of the Humans, which the executive producer was Michael Moore, and it brought up a lot of stuff for heaps of us. And did you want to speak to it? Because I did have a small word with Bill McKibben when he was here some years ago. I wanted to do an interview with him because the book that he wrote, The End of Nature, which I read in the year 2000, it stunned me. It was a superbly written book. And here he was in Planet of the Human, and the thing that stunned me the most was that he didn't know where his funding had come from. And that sort of hit me. And then I saw Al Gore, and I have seen that Al has been quite involved once with the Chicago Stock Exchange and carbon credits and carbon trading. And I couldn't quite understand why he would put so much effort into the money side of it and have him very much involved. This disappointed me big time. And he's a very monetarist. He seems to be quite monetarily involved in this whole huge challenge. I know at one level, when you give your heart, all you want to do is not make money, but actually be a good representative of what you believe in.
The film is really problematic. On the first point, and this directly responds to your point about Bill McKibben, the first big thrust about the film was the nonsense of burning trees to generate electricity.
Yes.
And indeed, Bill, even in his own college town, where he's a professor in Vermont, had been a supporter of biomass used in that way, and was somewhat slow, I'd have to say, in coming around to being opposed to biomass. And I think the film very often played fast and loose with the timing of an extract of a piece of old footage or whatever, because it too often made it look as though that was somebody's current thinking rather than previous thinking. And biomass has a legitimate role, but it's only a stopgap until we get to being fossil-free for fuel. Yeah, there is a case to use some biomass because you're not pulling new carbon out of the ground. You're reusing stored carbon from the trees. So it was very unfair in that respect. Then the film was completely wrong about renewable energy. So, for example, it was saying that more energy is expended from fossil fuels to create solar panels and wind turbines than that machinery then turned around and produced. Completely wrong. For solar panels, the ratio is 1 to 26, so you get 26 times more energy out. For wind turbines, it's 44 times. And there is real progress on starting to remove fossil fuels from energy systems. There's a long way to go, but the UK is already producing more electricity from renewable energy than it is from gas, coal and oil. And that's a huge turnaround for a country that was based on a coal-driven industrial revolution. And then lastly, the biggest problem, the film fell back on the worst argument of all, that the real problem is there's too many people on the planet. But the human population is only growing at 1% a year on the planet, but consumption is growing at 3% a year. So it is, when you start, you've run out of any sensible arguments when you start talking about population policy. The issue, because of the population, human population will plateau naturally. So what we've got to do is make sure that those people live well with the planet and its ecosystems, not against it. And I believe that 10 billion people can live well on the planet on that basis.
Particularly if we stop planned obsolescence. That's a huge one, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And so that takes us back to our consumption patterns. And then more fundamentally, it takes us back to, well, how are we actually making, what resources are we using and what industrial processes are we using to make the items that we consume? And that's true about the food we consume as well. So this is I'm going right back to what I was saying at the very beginning. The central preoccupation is that we have to make sure everything we do works with nature, not against it. And then 10 billion people will be able to live well on the planet.
This is fantastic. Thank you, Rod. Is there one last little 15, 20-second boost that you want to offer?
No, I think it just comes back to that. It's about living well with the planet, taking our foot off the neck of nature to give nature a chance to recover. That's become, unfortunately, a rather loaded expression I should probably stop using, because as the Black Lives Matter movement rightly starts to change things, and we see police brutality of policemen kneeling on people's necks, and killing them. That's a terrible phrase to use. But we've just got to let nature be itself and understand that it is our life support system. And that's why I just keep coming back to making sure that everything we do works with nature, not against it.
I did an interview of James Lovelock many years ago, and we were talking about the fact that the sudden increase in exponential growth of human beings and our industry moving so fast, cutting down a lot of the trees, putting up all the pollution and taking over sort of a lot of the land, that our planet just didn't have the time to actually go through the motions of all the bacteria working together to be able to pull in, and the trees, not enough trees to pull in the CO2, etc., that we were overwhelming Mother Earth's natural systems because we were just pushing it. We were just expanding too fast.
Well, at the same time, we're also destroying those natural systems.
That's right.
So every species we lose, we snip a thread in the web of life, and we have no idea often what role that species played. You know, that species exists for a reason, and we might not understand that reason, but if we wipe out that species, we have weakened the ecosystem. Now, there is obviously some natural dying off of species that cease to evolve and all that kind of stuff. But that by and large, is the issue for me, is that we have overwhelmed the system by crippling it, degrading it, by exploiting it, and overwhelming it with our sheer numbers. But we can bring this back into balance.
Thank you, Rod. I agree. I'm with you 100%. We can bring this into balance. And so I look forward to 2050, when the human race finally says, yes, we've done it. We've passed through this bottleneck into a fully flowering civilization and a very healthy, vital biosphere.
Well, we'll always be a work in progress, but I too picked that same magic date of 2050 because I will be 100 in 2050. So I am determined to get there, which is why my email address ends in nz2050.nz.
Excellent. Rod, thank you so much for coming in. I want to be able to talk to you about other things, and please come in. I want to talk about Agenda 21 and Agenda 2030 and many other things that are waiting for us to be able to discuss.
It would be my great pleasure. Thanks, Tim.
Thank you. That was Rod Oram. He's an investigative political, economic and business journalist here in New Zealand. Decide to network. Use every letter you write, every conversation you have, every meeting you attend, every email you send. And remember, even Facebook. To tweet and to express your fundamental beliefs and dreams. Affirm to others the vision of the world you want. Network through thought. Network through action. Network through love. Network through the spirit. You are the center of a network. You are the center of the world. You are a free, immensely powerful source of life and goodness. Affirm it, spread it, radiate it. Think day and night about it, and you will see a miracle happen. The greatness of your own life in a world of big powers, media and monopolies, but of 7.7 billion individuals, networking is the new freedom, the new democracy, a new transparency, and a new form of wholeness and happiness. This originated by Dr. Robert Muller, Chancellor of the World Peace University in Costa Rica, Central America. I invite you to be able to come to greenplanetfm.com, where we have over 500 interviews in our database, which you can readily download and listen to. To be able to inspire yourself to become the change you want to see in the world and become involved in caring for your children and grandchildren's future, we are also on Facebook, on Green Planet FM and ourplanet.org. Please come and love us. This is Tim Lynch
and Lisa Eyre.
In the spirit of Aroha, wishing you a wonderful week. We look forward to being with you next week. I say Kia Kaha and Haere Rā.